Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. And today I've got Shan Foisy. She's a designer on Azure Maps, and this is pretty cool because I want to hear about designing for developers, designing for maps. Cartography design is complicated.
It's extremely complicated, yes. And one of the things that we really wanted to take into consideration when designing Azure Maps was to keep the Azure customer in mind and really design something that would enable a variety of cloud-based scenarios to be possible, as well as customers overlaying their own data onto the map.
That's an interesting point, because it's not just something that someone just uses, like, here are the tiles. It's one layer. It's perfect for everyone. There's hundreds of layers?
Over 400 layers.
Okay. Yeah. They have to scale at multiple zoom levels. Mm-hmm. Some are vectors, some are rasters, some have custom data, some don't. It's complicated.
Yes, extremely complicated. So I think one of the things to take into consideration is when Azure Maps approached this, they were design first. When it comes to the styling. And that meant a very intentional decision to hire a designer first, cartographer second. So I came on early on in the product cycle, and I really started with a deep dive in comparing other consumer-based and enterprise-level map styles and really looking at a way of how are we going to differentiate Azure Maps so that someone can eventually look at the map and be like, oh, that's an Azure Map. And in this differentiation process, it really comes in the subtleties, because a map is still a representation of reality, right? Mm-hmm. So water still needs to be some shade of blue, you know, parks need to be some shade of green. So taking that into consideration and then working to build a cohesive map canvas that we can really build upon. So after a couple months of that, I had a schema developed that I could work on and build from there.
Yeah, not to mention, I would think accessibility issues around red-green color blindness and making sure that everything pops appropriately for everybody.
Yes.
So what's on your screen there?
This is the JSON style file, which is what controls the whole style. Mm. So these attributes in here, they meet with the raw map data from our partner TomTom, and then that is rendered in the map control, which is what produces, you know, the actual, you know, physical map that we see there.
Oh, interesting.
So each one, as I mentioned, over 400 entities or layers, if you will, and each one of them has a unique set of attributes that dictates, one, what it looks like on the map, how it looks on different zoom levels, and also how it interacts with other entities on the map. You know, in mapping, you have instances where things can collide. So you have to keep that in mind in the padding around everything as you zoom. So just a quick look through on this. This is just a landmark label, for example.
Live in this. This is like your place.
Yes, yes. I have a map styling tool that I do use to help generate some of this. But for the most part, it's in here. And a lot of zooming in and zooming out.
And the interesting about the zooming in and zooming out is that you're controlling kind of information density.
Exactly.
Right? You don't want to find that zoom step 10 has exactly what you want, but then when you go to zoom step 11, important stuff disappeared.
Exactly. In cartography, it's very, very important to show the right thing at the right time. So I can kind of walk you through. Here you can see this is the min-max zoom. So we want this to show up at level 12 and disappear at level 20. And we can also look at, here it dictates, general, font stack for this, which also has fallback fonts for other language support and other non-Latin characters. And this is a good example here of, at level 12, we want this text to be 9-point. At level 17, we want it to be 12-point. And you think about, other than just styling the 400 entities, each one of these entities can have unique attributes at 20 different zoom levels. So quick math will tell you that there's a potential of 8,000 individual design decisions that have to be made on just the base map.
Wow, that's quick maths.
Yeah.
So you do this yourself with your team of, and you have a cartographer that works with you?
I'm both. I'm designer.
You are the
and
cartographer as well?
Yeah.
Now, were you a cartography and a map geek and a designer?
I've been a map geek my whole life. Yes, I was often found looking at atlases rather than Saturday morning cartoons.
Yeah, so. the big giant coffee table ones.
Yes, yeah. Those ones.
That's cool. So the thing that I think is most interesting about what you said is that multi-dimensionality of it, right? You need to make 20 different maps and 400 different entities look good at all the different kind of the Cartesian products, no pun intended, of all of that and make it look good.
Yeah. we can kind of do a walking example here. Mm-hmm. You know, and things to take into consideration, just the general principles of map design, legibility and balance. Can we see things and instantly understand them? There should be no guessing mm-hmm. in cartography. Contrast, how are we distinguishing things? Mm-hmm. Focus, the difference of between foreground and background and how we're showing that. Mm-hmm. And then hierarchy is very important on a map. How are we showing likenesses, differences, and then interrelationships on the map as well? So just a look at Seattle here from, I think this is approximately a level Zoom level 12, the parks are showing up at a certain level, the neighborhoods are showing up, different roads are showing up, and we become more and more granular as we come down. Our polygon showing where our hospitals are, our schools, shopping centers, etc. All the way down to the building level, data is showing up at the appropriate time.
And it's interesting because it seems to do the right thing at all levels. I noticed when you zoomed in there, some of the text curved around a street as it turned. Some are vertical, and it just seems to do the right thing. Like you can see right here, the distance between James Way and Broadway, and then as James Way turns into Cherry Street, all appropriately spaced. None of it feels crowded.
Yeah, that's a big challenge, especially in a dense urban city. Another big part of this was the iconography design as well. We had an entire set of custom sprites that had to be developed to help show the differences between different points of interest categories, different cartographic labels. And included in that were road shields. We kind of take it for granted, you know, all the different road shields around the world. There's approximately 155 general types of road shields. Mm. And so part of this process is I did a design refresh on all 155 of them mm-hmm. so that they would better interact with the map canvas that we
wow.
designed.
Not to mention, I would assume, the geopolitical ramifications of, like, you know, one road shield might look appropriate to an American, it might be different for an Australian, or a European might feel differently about that shield because it's not the right one.
Yeah, so you know, all the shields are, that's all dictated by the actual raw map data from TomTom, which shield shows up where.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's all neutral ground to truth, as you'd say, so that that road shield that's showing up on your map is the same one that you're going to see if you're standing on that road in mm-hmm. the middle of Germany.
Of all these different entities and all these different things that you're doing, which is the most complicated for you to style?
The roads, definitely. There's 64, I believe, different types of roads in this data alone. You know, have your freeways, your highways, your major roads, your all the way down to your non-public road.
Yeah, your long rural driveway.
Exactly. So the thing to keep in mind there is each one of those roads has a toll version. It has a tunnel version. It has a toll tunnel version. So it really multiplies quickly. And then on top of that, you have the labels, you have the icons. So when you're working in a really dense city, it can become very complex very quickly. I have actually Paris pulled up over here, which is a great example of just this spider web of roads.
Yeah, totally different than Seattle.
Totally different. Yeah, this spider web of roads coming into the city center. Mm-hmm. And that's a perfect example of, again, showing the right thing at the right time. So as we zoom, the road thickness is changing. Different colored roads are showing up with different outlines, different thicknesses and opacities. Down to your city level when you start seeing your minor roads. And then even down
even paths in the park.
Yep, so we have paths in the park, we have parking roads, we have ferry roads, town grass paths versus, you know, town paved paths. So a lot of different entities on a granular level.
And what are these lines in the water?
Those are the ferry roads, yes.
Ferries have roads.
Most major routes in the world are all shown on the map.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. So I'm overwhelmed with the amount of work that your team has done, and I want to ask, when are you done? Like, will you ever finish?
I would like to know myself. No, map design it really doesn't end, is the truth, because the world's constantly changing, and so the data has to constantly change, and the way that we interact with maps is changing based upon that. You know, we're not just using a map to get from a distant point A to point B anymore. We're using it to explore the world directly around us. Mm. And so by default, you know, our location is the center of the world now. And so maps are going to continue to evolve based on that. And I plan on being here to make sure that Azure Maps and our, and this style and any future styles do that as well.
Very cool. And then I and our viewers can reap all of the benefits by simply using Azure Maps, by going into the Azure portal, signing up for Azure Maps, and we get all these benefits in our applications.
Yep, this is the main style that you start out working with when you begin to use Azure Maps.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
I am learning about all the hard work that goes into the design and the complexities of Azure Maps here on Azure Friday.